Well, I'm glad to be back in San Diego. Hallelujah. Father's doing great things all over the earth. I know it looks pretty dark if you're looking around you, but you know, just need to start looking in the right direction. Because though there is darkness over the people and gross darkness over the land, God's got a remedy. You know what he's going to do? He's going to rend the heavens and come down. Not. It's not what it says. He done rend the heavens long ago. And they didn't get sewed back together. Hallelujah. His remedy is that we arise. That's what he said. He says, darkness is over the land, gross darkness is over the people. Now rise and shine. He tells us to arise because the glory of the Lord has come upon us and shines upon us like the sun at noonday. That I seriously deal with some darkness. As I'm telling you right now. The Lord says that the day is evil, but we got the remedy. Everybody wants God, come do it. No. He's already come and done it. And through the miracle power of the cross, he changed you and gave you everything you need to be the light of the world. He didn't say a light. He said the light. And we want to be preoccupied with a lot of different things. I'm going to tell you right now, if you just begin to become that sojourner and pilgrim, that person of the heavenly realm, you'll find out that you really had joy unspeakable all the time, didn't know it. You had peace that passes understanding all the time, you just didn't realize it. You had the solution for all men. See, the Lord said, the day is evil. Redeem the time, for the day is evil. Don't be unwise. And of course, the word is actually much more radical than that, but I'm not going to lay it on you tonight. But be wise, knowing what is the will of God. Don't be drunk with wine, wherein is debauchery. But be filled with the Holy Ghost. The redemption of the way to redeem the times, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Same as that we are the light of the world. City set upon a hill cannot be hid. You know, for me, I mean, the one thing that expresses the rivers of the Holy Ghost is men and women and boys and girls coming into a place in God where they've been taught how to let the Holy Ghost flow through their passions and emotions. Jesus said, out of your kolia shall flow rivers of living water. I use the Greek word there in the context of all the English words of John chapter 7, verse 38. 39. And kolia literally means out of your emotions and out of your passions, and people just have not learned to do that. That is the first great display of rivers. Hallelujah. And we just want you to start enjoying it. It ain't hard to do. You just got to say it's a decision. Everything that goes on in your life is a decision that you make. You're either making good decisions or you're making bad decisions. Huh? I don't really believe that there's any, well, it wasn't a good one, it wasn't a bad one. Huh? I believe it's either good decision or bad decisions, because I believe the only good decisions are those decisions made in agreement with God. Huh? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then any other decision, by definition, is bad. Ha ha! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I got a whole lot of good news for you tonight. God's got lots of good things for you. All you got to do is receive. And so those of you don't know how to receive, I got some good news for you. God the Holy Ghost is here to teach you how. He's going to work on you. And some of you may be slow learners. I mean, it just happens. You know what? The Lord doesn't kick slow learners out of the class. Huh? He just is long-suffering and is patient. Hallelujah. And the only problem is that you having to wait a whole lot longer than you needed to be richly blessed. You were having to wait a whole lot longer than you needed to enjoy the splendor of heaven. You know, we are a new race. Did you know that? Huh? Some people want to be of different races. You know what I'm saying? Of course, James knows what I'm saying. Been living in Louisiana too long. But God made a new race. In Christ Jesus, it's a new race. Of all nationalities, of every tongue, of every tribe, of every language, it's a new race. We've been born of the Spirit. We have been translated out of the kingdom of this world over into Christ Jesus. As real as God made a new race when he called Abraham, and we call them Jews today, God made a new race, a heavenly people, born of the Spirit, washed in the blood. His royal blood now flows through our veins. Now, if the church would simply be what the church is supposed to be, we'd have the cure for everything. Amen. Hallelujah. We'd have the cure for everything. It's just that so many people just want to live out their own life instead of go ahead and just submit yourself to the Lord and say, listen, I no longer live. I no longer live. That is a difficult one. That's a difficult one because you're sitting right there talking to me right now. But God worked a miracle that we have to agree with. Hey, just think about it. Think about it. The angel appears to Mary and says, you're going to have a baby from God. That is harder to say. That is harder to believe than what I just told you. That is harder to believe than what I just told you. Bless her heart. What did she do? Look at the wisdom. She's a young girl. She said, be it unto me according to your word. How hard is that, dear people? It ain't hard. It ain't hard. And all you got to do is agree with God and you have the miracle. You don't agree with God, you're going to have nothing. The Father has given us the miracle now to no longer have our own life. See, when we say we no longer live, we ought to just say, Christ Jesus lives now. I got the life of God. And I don't know what it's going to take for people to get excited about the fact that they got the life of God. But if I can get you into a place where you agree with God and say, I've got the life of God, I've got the life of the Holy Ghost, I've got the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, I've got the life of the Father, and I don't want to live no more. Amen. And I no longer live. I experienced the great exchange. The Greek word is kartalege, which we use in the scriptures. For example, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, that says, we have been given the ministry of reconciliation. Hallelujah. That means we've been given the ministry of kartalege, the exchange. He exchanged his life for ours. Good trade. Woo-hoo. Somebody said, well, I'm this and I'm that. Well, you can be this or you can be that if you want. But Father has called everybody come be collected in Christ Jesus, his son, to where that now we don't exist outside of him. We find all our life in him. This is the only kind of life we want to live. Now, listen, I know it's tough in the Western world. You are saturated in a Greek society. And you have been culturized since you were 4 years old, at least in some little school where somebody's demanding you to believe something and agree with it. And then they give you red marks all over your paper if you don't. They're constantly checking up just how well you've been brainwashed with the culture. The Father has called us into the realms of the kingdom of God, and the Holy Spirit is here to teach us every day how to agree with what God has to say, and it is entirely diametrically opposed to everything that you've learned. You're going to have to come in and be completely and totally re-educated. Amen. It is the school of unlearning. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that's usually the biggest problem, because we find in third world countries, it's so easy to get people over into the glory land and just get them flowing in all the gifts of the Spirit. And just becomes so natural to see them born again and baptized in the Holy Ghost all at the same time, because they don't have all these doubts and confusion and fear that some denomination put in their head about how spooky the Holy Ghost is. Jesus. And we can just go ahead and live out the life of God. And just go ahead and live out the life of Jesus. You just go ahead and live out the life of the Holy Ghost. He that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Praise the name of Jesus Christ. Listen, and this is so important. And I want you just to open up your Bibles into Mark chapter 6. And what I think it would be verse
What is the last verse? Is the last verse of Mark chapter 6, verse 56? I think it is. Go ahead and look in Mark 6. See if the last verse of Mark chapter 6 is verse 56. It is? Okay, we're on good track. We're on good ground. Praise God. Ha, ha, ha. Hallelujah. Everybody say ha, ha, ha.
Ha, ha, ha.
Ha, ha, ha. He has filled my mouth with laughter. Ha, 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 ha. You know, the Lord spent all the 80s trying to get the church ready. You know what I'm saying? He spent all the 80s with one little song. Went all over the United States. He's filled my mouth with laughter. Ha, 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 ha. It's actually written in the late 70s. Became popular in the 80s. And to help people understand how easy it is to just say yes to God and be happy. Hallelujah. And the reality of it is, dear people, we're going to have to be willing to participate with these wonderful attributes and character and nature of the Spirit of the Lord if we're going to begin to participate in a greater dimension with the ministry of Jesus. And, you know, I'm going to talk to you about two things that I left up talking to you about in the last meeting that I was here with you in. And that is, Jesus said, I want you to come and learn how to come in to my ministry. I want you to learn in my ministry. I want you to see how my ministry works. He said, I'm meek and lowly. I want you to learn how to take my yoke, my servitude. I'm meek and lowly. This is how you move and flow in the Holy Ghost and the dimensions of the miraculous. That runs counter to everything we've been taught, everything that we glamorize, everything that we have come to admire. We really believe in competition. We are Greekized. We really believe in comparisons, and we really believe in, really believe in compromise big time. All of those are demonic realms. You can prove it, that they're demonic realms from the Word of God, not some kind of, you know, subjective reasoning, some kind of philosophical logic. Just simply God, what God has to say about these things. And Holy Spirit wants to show us how to walk in lowliness and meekness, not in arrogance and pride. He wants to show us, you know, how to give ourselves over to a place of being clothed with humility and walk in love, how to take a towel and basin and wash people's feet and really feel honored about it. When somebody asks you, what do you think that you are capable of doing? You would respond and say, I think I would make a great servant girl. Or I think I would make a great hand washing boy. You feel it? They're dialing 911 right now. They're filing out the back door. You got to be kidding me. This is the kingdom of God. Jesus says, come on, I'll show you how it works. This is a whole different realm. Father lives in a whole different realm than the Luciferian cult, than the demonic realm, than that which is the prince of the power of the air that is teaching men our culture, that has taught men what our society is supposed to look like, that has dominated the hearts and the minds of men. Father's looking for a whole other dimension of people to begin to agree with him, a heavenly people, a people of the Holy Ghost, a people who walk in the Spirit, are led by the Spirit, are taught of God, who's taken on the very life of Christ Jesus, whose purpose is to do the will of the Father. I mean, this Father has made the most important thing. He says those who say, Lord, Lord, are not coming into the kingdom necessarily. If they do the will of the Father, they are, but if they don't do the will of the Father, they're not. The will of the Father is supreme. I mean, this is what Jesus' ministry is all about. I don't do my own will. It's what Father says. I don't say my own stuff. It's what Father says. You got a whole Bible full of what Father says. A lot of people don't even take time to read it. He said, I'm just giving myself over to be his servant. I'm the servant. And I'm not only his servant, I'm your servant too. Let me show you. This is how the anointing works. Mark 6:65, when he gets out of the boat, immediately he was recognized. This is the way the church should be. Immediately they recognize Jesus. They take off, lickety-split, running here, every which direction, to go gather up everybody they knew that was sick and diseased, that was hurting, all of the relatives. They went and sound the alarm. Guys, the healer has come. The healer is here. Get all of your sick people and bring them on their cots. And all you've got to do is just get near him, and you're going to be healed. And then what they were saying is, they began, there's that word there from which we derive a word used of the Holy Ghost, parakaletos. This particular is parakaleo. Parakaleo means to beg, to plead. See, that's who the Holy Ghost is. He's begging us and he's pleading with us. Yeah, we like to kind of, you know, make it a real fanciful word and say beseech. But really, when you look at those words like comforter, helper, and they are good. Those are fine words, comforter, helper. The one that gives you a strong sense of security. My. When you begin to get a strong sense of security, you can kind of understand what it means to be meek but bold, huh? To walk in humility but total confidence, huh? There's no models for it in this earthly realm. There's no models for it in the worldly realm among men. You have to go get taught by the Holy Ghost. Uh-huh. You got to go watch men, women who are taught by the Holy Ghost who said, okay, I'm not fashioning myself after men no more. I'm not fashioning myself after the conversation of the world anymore. I'm not going to be a part of all these things that live or where people live and stride and hate and variance and comparisons and everybody trying to be whatever it is they're trying to be and find some self-worth in the imaginations of their own worth. When Christ Jesus purchased us and made us his purchased possession, when he filled us with the glory of the treasure chest of heaven, when he gave to us all this power residing on the inside of us, he said unto him who is able to do superabundantly above all you think or ask, according to the power that you pray down from heaven when you start agonizing and fasting and praying. Come on, give me a big gong. Thank you. Huh? Because that's how people slide stuff over on people all the time. Take a verse of scripture, you know what? 90% of that verse of scripture was true. 10% of it was wrong. But it's how people practice it. It's orthopraxy, not orthodoxy. I want to get orthodoxy and orthopraxy brought together in the life of Jesus, the eternal word, the living word, who showed us the fullness of the word of God and manifest for us the fullness of the will of God, and at the same time showed us the fullness of the Spirit, so we can begin to have an impact on the world around us instead of sitting by acting like somehow God's going to come down here and fix this situation when he put it in our care, when he gave us the authority, when he gave us the responsibility. He said, I give you all power and authority. God hates a false witness, dear people. And we're going to have to take upon our shoulders the responsibility which he's given to us to be witnesses that he raised from the dead, that he has all power and authority over death, hell, and the grave, over every form of sickness and disease and sin, over the mind-blinding spirits of darkness, that Satan can no longer hold men under his evil sway. We are the ones who show forth that glory today by the very deeds and actions of our lives. It's our responsibility. And you and I will be held accountable for it one day, and we're spending all of our riches on that which cannot profit. We're trading in all of our royal and priestly garments. God made us priests and kings, and we live like wretched poor person. Huh? In the spirit, people who've never known, you know, the etiquette of a kingly and priestly realm. Come on, let the Holy Ghost teach you. Oh, come on, fall in love with the life of God. Say, my, Papa, I believe your life's a whole lot better than anyone I could have ever imagined for myself, anyone I could have ever created. You know, men basically take you through the education system, try to strip you of all ego and reshape you in their own image, and they've done a very good job of it. But reality, while they were doing that, they were actually shaping you in a demonic image. Because that's all that they know. Their father is the devil. God came and rescued us through Christ Jesus and gave us a whole new beginning and said, now here's the Holy Spirit. He wants to shape you in every way and build you up and strengthen you in every way according to that gift of righteousness and that gift of holiness that I gave you. Yes. Hallelujah. How many holy people do we have in here? Praise God. Somebody knows the truth. Hallelujah. God gave us a gift of holiness. He says, be holy even as I'm holy. How are you going to have that kind of holiness unless he gives it to you? Hallelujah. He said, everyone that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. And then there's only one other alternative. Huh? Yeah. He that sins is of the devil. That's just it. It's just that way. It's light and darkness, truth and life. Huh? It's light and darkness, truth or lie, death or lie. He's brought us over into this wonderful realm of heaven. So we can be taught of God. He would sit around all pocket faced with their religious attitudes. Talk about all the scripture they know. Are you listening to me, Gloria? Come on. It's about time we get stripped of all that stuff. It's about time we lay aside those beggarly garments and take on these priestly robes, these kingly robes. It's about time we get crowned with glory and honor and say, wait a minute, I'm here being mentored by God to rule and reign with Him forever. I've stepped over in my inheritance. I've been made heir of God, co-inheritor with Jesus Christ. He's given me all authority in Him. He has all authority in heaven and earth, and He's looking for someone to agree with them. He's given me authority and power to tread over scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, so that nothing shall by any means hurt me. He's given me the authority to cast out devils, speak with new tongues, lay hands on the sick. There's nothing deadly or poisonous that can touch me. The flame cannot kindle upon me. Hallelujah. Have you ever read Hebrews chapter 11? They escaped the edge of the sword. They put to flight the armies of the aliens. Out of weakness were made strong. They wrought righteousness. They quenched the violence of fire. Stopped the mouths of lions. Father's just looking for some people that won't compromise no more, won't try to fit into the world, won't try to fit in with the demons around them, try to get approval from Satan himself. Are you listening to me? Oh, yeah, it's all masked. It's masked. It's one big gigantic deception. God has brought to us the word to open up our eyes, to give us an understanding, a light so that we can see where to place every step as we walk, hallelujah, in the footsteps of the Lord Jesus Christ, being taught of the Holy Ghost how to function in such majesty and splendor and glory and authority. Oh, see how easy it gets to say, I no longer live? I don't want to, you see. Now all of a sudden how easy it gets to say, I hate my life that I had in this world. My, you ought to see the glory I got now. I'm not going back to that old stinky shack. It was nothing more than an outhouse with an extra room. I'm not going back to eating out of that polluted realm. I'm not going back to those things that belong to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. That's all the pleasures that Satan can come up with. You can drink from that polluted sewer if you want. But Father has caused us to come and enjoy pleasures at His right hand. He's coming to show Panadea what it's really all about. Satan's been running his ruin. He's been doing his stuff to keep people distracted and preoccupied. You have no idea the glory and ecstasy and pleasure that it is His right hand and the joy forevermore till you begin to listen to the Holy Spirit, till you begin to shut down bad attitudes, wrong thinking, wrong behavior. And not by your own ability, but by a supernatural power that God has given. It is amazing. According to His divine power, He's given us everything we need to shut down everything contrary to His ways. According to His divine power, He's given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Why? Because He's called us to glory and virtue. He wants His glory to shine through our lives in the beauty of His joy, in the beauty of His holiness, in the beauty of His peace, in the beauty of His celebration, and the dancing. Hallelujah. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Sad is everyone who's not. Mandexipo. Sad are the religious of the day. They don't. Sad. They live in condemnation. They live under guilt and shame. Huh? That's religion for you. You step into a relationship with Jesus Christ. You let the Holy Ghost show you what all He did for you at Calvary. What He did for you when He went down into hell for 3 days. What He did for you when He rose from the dead. What He did for you when He ascended up on high and was exalted to the right hand of the Father. What He did for you when He poured out the Holy Ghost. All of a sudden, shame, condemnation, guilt, a sense of separation will no longer exist. When that happens, you step into the miraculous, like breathing. It's natural. You don't even have to try to do anything anymore. It's just like breathing. Hallelujah. It's just is natural. And you know, I love to tell the story of when Ann and I stood on the platform in a stadium jam-packed with Orthodox Hindus. And there was an Assemblies of God band up playing. They'd been up playing for an hour and a half, I don't know. Beautiful worship music, anointed worship music. And there was relative peace. And, you know, tranquility in the house, as it were, in that huge stadium in Kathmandu, Nepal, where it was said there would never be ever a possibility that the gospel of Jesus Christ could ever be preached from that icon of the kingdom of Hinduism. And we stood up there, and all we did was go, hello, and demons, just with a hello, just with a hello. Just because we live in this wonderful realm of divine power and glory. But just at the hello, the devils, as literally thousands of demon spirits begin to come out of people. And it was a wild manifestation as those who were schizophrenic were delivered, as those who had the demons of the kundalini, the release of the serpent spine that is now a part of yoga that people have taken, that they actually do in churches right now. But that possesses, that demon that possesses them, the Brahmas, the demon of Brahmanism that possesses them, the manic depressives, all kinds of crazy things that were in these Orthodox Hindus, as the power of God shook them with a hello. Hallelujah. It was crazy for a little while as they're thrashing all over the place, but oh, the brightness and the shining glory upon their face that was soon to come, just because somebody was willing to go all the way with God. And I'm hoping that there's going to be a somebody here that'll quit living such a ridiculous, silly, you know, terrible existence of sorrow and sadness and can't ever get ahead. I'm always offended and I'm always mistreated and I'm always unhappy and I'm always dissatisfied. I'm always discouraged and never can do it right. Loser. Failure. Being cheated. Being deprived. Come on. Father's given us an unspeakable gift. He gave us his life. And it seems as so few people want it. I mean, he poured out his most precious gift. The eternal Word, his only begotten Son, who was hid in his bosom, that he made a holy embryo when the Holy Ghost overshadowed a woman, a young maiden, a young virgin named Mary, who, and he became, the eternal Word became a holy embryo, and God was made flesh. He became the sin offering so that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. When he then took and said, I've got to give them my very, 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 very best. I want to give them the greatest riches that I have. And he looked to the Holy Ghost and poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost to so many people, snubbed their nose at and have their finger of accusation pointed towards them. They know very little about him, if anything. And yet, he's so sacred. He's not sacred to people of the church, but all he's sacred to Father. He's sacred to Jesus. Jesus said, you can say whatever bad thing you want to say about me, and it'd be forgiven you. But you say one bad thing about the Holy Ghost, and I tell you with absolute certainty, you will never be forgiven, not in this life nor in the life to come. You will never be forgiven. Never. And then he repeats it. You can say whatever you want to say bad about the Father. As holy as the Father is. I mean, Father is holy, holy, holy. I mean, just imagine all that God labored to reveal and to establish in the hearts of humanity as he tried to declare to them and reveal to them how different he was from the demonic realm. As different as the sun shining at noonday from the darkness where there is no light. And Jesus said, you can say whatever you want bad about Father, even though he's holy, holy, holy. And it will be forgiven you. But I'm going to tell you with absolute certainty, you listen to me. What I'm going to give you is so sacred, it's so precious, that if you say anything evil against him, you transgress him, you walk over him in any way, you outrage him, it will never be forgiven you, not in this life and in the life to come. And we spend most of our days laboring with God's people just to like God's great riches. Just to consider God's great riches, like we're trying to sell them some brass coins of no value. Like we're trying to sell them some buttons, you know, that are plastic. Are you listening to me? Oh, people. I pray that you will receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of him, that you can begin to appreciate what he's done for us. That it won't be any longer veiled from you because of religion. See, there's so many people that the glory of God and what he's done through the new covenant, they just walk around with a veil. They can't see it. They can't look at it. They can't behold it. Religion has got them veiled. hardness of heart has got him veiled. And God says by his servant Paul, he says, take the veil off. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, and he says, now look in the mirror and behold that glory. Behold the image. Hallelujah. Behold the very image of the living God. There be changed from glory to glory. Hallelujah. I'll tell you right now, I ripped that veil off. And people who are stuck in comparisons and live in suspicion and criticism and always got something bad to say or something, you know, concern, they'll never know this way. Because they live in it, they live under the oppression of a demonic spirit called envy and strife. So many people are sad in their countenance because they're oppressed with demon spirits. They've agreed with lies. They believed things that are not true. They've accepted behaviors, and they have sanctified behaviors that are opposed and opposite to the Holy Ghost. And Father wants to show us how to get rid of that stuff and begin to bring forth fruit to perfection. You're going to hear me about talking to you about bringing forth fruit to perfection. I'm never going to stop. I'm never going to stop. Because the Lord says they never bring forth fruit to perfection because they're just compromised with the cares of this world, deceitfulness of riches and pleasures of this life. You know, the Lord hasn't left us without insight. He's given us clear insight as to what we're supposed to do if we're going to agree with the Holy Ghost, move with Him, and be trained now to function in His ministry. Because look at what's going to happen. Look at what I believe what should happen. I mean, you know, over and again we see the ministry of Jesus as He heals everyone who is sick and everyone who is diseased, how He brings the cure and He brings the remedy. Nobody, listen, people aren't going to be offended anymore when you lay hands on them and say, Jesus, and they get healed. They might say, well, time out a minute. What'd you just do to me? What'd you say? You can't say that. That's offensive. You're not supposed to say that. Huh? But all of a sudden, they've got the remedy, and suddenly they begin to fall in love with the Master. Huh? When Jesus stepped into the boat there, and actually the previous chapter, I'll just stay in chapter 6, verse 56, because I hardly got onto that yet. But in the previous chapter, actually it's probably in 6, chapter 6, forgive me. Just the previous events, you know, Jesus has multiplied the loaves and the fishes. He's fed the multitudes. He comes walking across the stormy water. He steps into the boat. They're all just flabbergasted, astonished, going, you know, they're just astonished and afraid, going, what? Who is he? What just happened? And Jesus, you know, you can just see him just smiling. You know, he's got total authority over everything. They still don't get it. He says they can't even reckon because the hardness of their heart. They can't even consider that we just multiplied loaves and fish. We just multiplied a few loaves and a few fishes and fed the multitudes. They just can't get it. It just doesn't add up. The heart's still hardened. But every miracle softened the heart a little bit more. Come on now, listen to me. I mean, I'm telling you, Southern California, the heart's hardened. The hearts of America, the hearts of the Western world are hardened. But if what happens, if somebody will begin to come into the school of the Holy Ghost and be willing to be trained to live out the life and ministry of Jesus Christ, who'll begin to get excited to say, I no longer live, God lives over here. And you begin to take on the identity, you begin to take up the mantle. To be endued is to take up the mantle, or to put on the Lord Jesus Christ is to take up the mantle. People want to talk about the mantle of Elijah. Listen, I mean, that might be glamorous and glorious, but ain't nothing to compare to the mantle of the Lord Jesus Christ that He's given to us. There's nothing to compare. Elisha got to do double works to Elijah. Jesus said you get to do greater works. That's unlimited. Ooh, greater works. Anyone. You know, I was sharing last night about Jonathan Goforth. Jonathan Goforth, after having graduated from seminary at Princeton and becoming as a Presbyterian minister, one day he got real with God. And he read that verse of scripture in John 14:12. And suddenly he wasn't reading it like this. Peter, James, and John, if you believe, the works which I do, shall you do in greater works. Suddenly the word anyone leaped up off the page and stood in front of him and danced around. Anyone. Anyone who believes. And he had to reckon, wait, wait a minute, do I even believe here? And then all of a sudden, the reality that if anybody receives this salvation and drinks of this water, which Christ Jesus supplies, that the very life of an expression of God would flow out of them like rivers. First, it will be a deluge of rivers. Power comes upon you. We deal with so many people who are hardened to the heart. They compromise the life of God, the Holy Spirit, and they can't receive what Father is easily supplying and is coming as a deluge of rivers upon you, sweep you away in His glory, so that that glory can flow out of you. And here's Jonathan Goforth saying, I don't have any of this. Somebody got real for a minute. It is amazing how far God will take you when you just get real for a minute. See, God's a spirit of truth. He's a spirit of truth. He's not hooking up with a lie, not a little one, not a kind of one, not a pretend one, not a poser. You listen to me. Hallelujah. So many people are under the demonic oppression that the word of God is discouragement to them. They're oppressed by demon spirits. They bought into a demon spirit, alive a demon spirit. They never renounced it. They've let it reign over them. And that demon spirit continually browbeats them, condemns them, makes them feel like a failure. It's a demonic power. Easily. A hello will get rid of it. Just an anointed hello. Unless it's become fortified by religion. Christianity, the religion that is associated with Jesus, will literally fortify you against what the Holy Ghost would try to bring you. Isn't that a paradox? Isn't that a wild idea? But look at the Pharisees. Look at the so many people that we've gone through the various different events in the history of the church. They've literally been fortified against the Holy Ghost of hardening their hearts against Him and deafening their ears to hear Him. I pray tonight in Jesus' name that none of this will be in your lives. Amen. You know, God has called us to step into such a beautiful and a glorious ministry. Yeah. To step into this wonderful life. And first and foremost, you know, it's just understanding the splendor of relationship with Him. The splendor of the gift that we've been given. And it really isn't about the things that we do for Him. But mind, when you're standing over here in this realm of beholding His glory, when you encounter this wonderful love, when you're just caught away and captivated by this romance, this divine romance, all of a sudden your heart's going to begin to beat with the same kind of a compassion, with the same kind of desire to see that which Father has purposed to do in the lives of people around you. You're not going to be willing to stand around and watch people live out a lie. Not a L-I-F-E, an L-I-E. To live out a lie when the truth has come to set them free. When they can be filled with this wonderful glory. Where they can live in a realm of joy unspeakable and full of glory. There's a lot of people who sit around sad and sorrowful and they say they have joy unspeakable and full of glory. What deception. Truth has never beckoned. The reality of truth has never been confronted. It's always just make believe and pretend. Oh my, but if we'll just listen to the Holy Spirit not harden our hearts and we begin to get real with Him, we say, Lord, I'm so sorry. Oh God, I want everything that You have for me. Lord, come, take control of my life. Shine the floodlight of heaven upon me. Show me, Lord, where I've had a mixture. Show me, oh God, where I've given my members over to unrighteousness and held myself back from all that You want to be through me. He comes. He just comes. Comes and fills us. You know, when I look at Mark 5 and verse 56 and see that how that all these people are saying, and this is in the territory of the Gentiles because it's in Gennesaret, and how they're saying, all we gotta do is touch the hem of His garment, and anybody who touches the hem of His garment will be made perfectly whole. Not just healed, they'll get it all. They get it all. And so the scripture says, and they begged Him that they might just touch the hem of His garment. And I'm going to tell you right now, I know what Jesus is going to do when somebody just asks. Much, much, much more beg. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And you know, I don't know that this is true, but I speculate that this woman with an issue of blood broke open a whole new dimension of access to Jesus. A one woman Because there's no speaking of this in the scripture until there's this one woman who, with the issue of blood, said within her heart, if I can but touch the hem of his garment, I will be made perfectly whole. And she had to go up against a whole lot of stuff. She had to go up against so much opposition that it just, I mean, it's just unimaginable, but she was even able to deal with it. First of all, she was unclean and wasn't allowed to be in the congregation of Israel. Second of all, she had a great multitude and crowd pressing up against Jesus. How do you get underneath them when you're so weak and sick? For she had been sick a long time and had spent all of her money on physicians and only grew all the worse. But her willingness to take a hold of something of reality and truth, and how this was born in her spirit, certainly would be just how it's born in our spirits as we begin to bring our petition before the Lord, and we're agonizing over and say, God, what do I got to do? How can I touch this realm? I know, Lord, that healing is the children's bread. How do I lay hold of that which you supplied? A lot of people never go to prayer that way. See, that's a relationship. That's a faith prayer, you see. It's usually, oh, God bless mom, pop, brother, sister, give us some more, amen. We have not because we ask not. When we ask amiss that we may consume it in our own interest and lust and desire. But what happens when we look at the beauty and the treasure and the splendor of the Word of God and say, "This is, I can have this. No one's restricted." Pop Seymour heard that in Kansas, the theologians and some famous preachers were talking about being baptized in the Holy Ghost. So he works his way from a small town in Texas over to Kansas. And because his skin color is black, they won't let him in the building. So Pop Seymour's got to sit out on the little steps, about just three steps. There wasn't no porch. He's got to sit out on the steps. And of course, they got the door shut because white folks got to stay warm. And Pop Seymour's sitting there in the elements. He's got his ear bent over there to the crack. Listen to what the preachers are saying about the Holy Ghost. And have a bad attitude. He's hungry for God. It's bigger than all the offenses that men can create. He's hungry for God. It's bigger than all the problems that men have. He's just hungry for God. What are they saying? None of the men that were in that building stepped into what they were talking about. Pop Seymour did. Pop Seymour stepped in. He was the only one. There were crowds coming and going. But there was only one person who found a place of meekness and lowliness, who found a place of some... See, it's easy. When you're just so hungry for Jesus, you're so hungry for the things of heaven, all of a sudden the stuff can't run counter. It's just because your heart's fixed. You don't have room for other stuff getting you. Huh? Your heart's full. It's full. It's him. You don't have any room for having some kind of problem, some kind of issue, some kind of, you know, offense, some kind of bad word to say, and boy, would he ever have the right to point the finger of accusation and stand up and protest. Protest is demonic in every form and shape. I don't see Jesus do it one time. Hallelujah. I just see people hidden away in God, and God comes to their defense. Hallelujah. When you get God involved, he's going to say, lay down your weapons. What we're going to have you do is walk around and shout. What we're going to do today? Ha! Woo! We're going to have you praise. Ha, 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 hallelujah. Wait a minute. Time out. What? These guys are coming with iron chariots and great long spears. They're going to kill us. We were already in bad shape. Now we're worse shape now that we inquire to God. Because before, at least we had some shields and swords and spears. And he said, got to lay those down today. Because if you want me to fight for you, you got to disarm yourself. But what happens when God becomes your shield, your suzerain, your benefactor? See, a suzerain, you're my shield, my exceeding great reward. When he becomes your shield, your suzerain, that means he's your provider, your protector, and your perfecter. That's what a suzerain is. You start believing that God is a good God. You start believing that he's a father that goes beyond any father who loves their children. He said, hey, just go ahead and contrast it. He said, I'm just going to contrast myself with you and call you evil. And if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, watch out what's going to happen through me. I'm going to give my kids the Holy Ghost. I'm going to give my kids, I'm going to give my children the kingdom. When you step into the authority that you've been authorized, certified, authorized, and given the authority. Anybody who had received him gave them the authority to be sons of God. As many as would believe on his name. Oh, God, I'm in the name of Jesus. Ruth, in Jesus' name. Now you're not going to have no more nauseousness. You're not going to have it. I said no in Jesus' name. I just end. It's over. Now, bang le say. Okay. Nere disusta. I got you. I got you over here. I got you. I have it.
Yes, in Jesus' name. No
pregnancy sickness. This ain't even right. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. Listen, I was in a meeting. You know, I walk in divine health. I haven't had any kind of a stomach flu for more than 20 years. I haven't even felt nauseous, except for when, you know, I get around somebody who's sick, and then I can feel the spirit of it, because it's a spirit. It's not a virus and all the rest. It's a spirit. Spirit of sickness. And I was praying, it was two nights ago, I was praying with some people. It was some pretty intense stuff. And all of a sudden, the first time in, I don't know, such a long, long time, I felt nauseous. I felt like I was going to throw up. I figured, well, my goodness, here I'm in the midst of this prayer. I feel this thing come on me. I feel like it's just right there. Could come, huh? And I was standing there going, this is nuts. And I figure everybody can see me white, sheet white, because I feel like I'm going to pass out. And I'm right in the middle of praying for people. Dealing with sickness and disease and all kinds of demonic stuff. Hallelujah. I just not going to bend my knee. Because I'm not going out. If it's going to come, it's going to fly and everybody's going to get shouting. Because I'm not bowing. I'm not going to bow. No, I'm not going to bow. Oh, I'm bowed to it. I'm not going to go with it. I'm not going to go with sin. I'm not going to go with temptation. Satan can make the most damnable thing look like something you can't live without. Satan can make the most cursed thing look like something that you must have. He's a master of his craft. He's the supreme warlock. He's the supreme sorcerer. He's a supreme shaman. He was able to deceive angels that stood before the Lord and beheld his glory for eons of years. What can he do to you and me? He ain't touching me. Huh? I've been born of the Spirit. Christ Jesus lived. The greater Lord lived. Hu bakarashaya. But you're going to be challenged. You're going to be challenged. You're going to be challenged on I-5 in the morning. Yeah, you are. You're going to find out how much you're willing to live with love and peace and gentleness and lay down your life and whether you're ready to go fisticuffs. Huh? Yeah. And it's going to be over something so stupid. You're going to trade your glory for something so stupid and selfish. It's like most of God's people didn't mature past 3. Emotionally, you with me? Psychologically, God the Holy Ghost wants his glory to flow out of us, God's own glory to flow out of our passions and our emotions and our thinking realm with an effulgency of power that it's like rivers. And you learn it when you begin to lift up your voice with all your heart. I was just with some people, and it's the first time I've ever worshiped with CDs because they don't have a music ministry. It's a smaller church, one of those places that Ann and I went. And I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen people worship more radically in my life. I mean, it was such extreme passion, and all they had was a CD. Why, you got these big churches with great music ministries all sitting around little lip sync. It's true. They've never allowed God the Holy Ghost to feel their passions and their emotions. They never went with it. They never learned how to go, he fills my mouth with laughter. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. to say, I'm not going to be without it. I'm not going to bow to the sorrow. I'm not going to bow to the sadness. I'm not going to bow to the strife. I'm not going to bow to the envy. I'm not going to bow to the discouragement. I'm not going to bow to the rejection. I'm not going to bow to the intimidation. I'm not going to bow to the fear. You're just faced with it continually. And this is the stronghold that keeps most people from ever moving on into the life of Jesus, because it says, come and learn of me. It's meek and lowly. You're going to have to come over here and make everything that you're about, that which God the Holy Spirit has brought to you for me. I take everything that belongs to the Father, and he's going to reveal it to you. He's going to transmit it to you. But so to many people that sit in the church, unfortunately, the things that the Holy Ghost have are not precious. They're not sacred. They're not desirable. They're not more to be desired than gold. They're not more to be desired than jewels and precious things and great riches. It's true. I pray tonight that that won't be any plotty in this place. No, such a stronghold is on your mind that it'd be broken tonight. Amen. I pray tonight that you'll grab a hold of us. I was so blessed. Josh Matos here, he said, you know, I was telling everybody, encouraging them, and said, listen, just pray to the, find out that you can have a Holy Ghost meeting every day at home. You can lose the English language every day. And I said, just go to prayer and just pray for an hour. Just pray till the glory touches you. Just pray. Just find time. Just pray. And it's not just agonizing, all these kinds of things that people do and call prayer. It's enjoying his presence. It's thanking him for his goodness and worshiping him for who he is and blessing him for all that he's done and the gifts that he's given. And just stand there. And Josh said, well, I went for an hour. And he said, you know, I just examined it. And I was like, you know, I had a little effect, but There was no breakthrough here. And I could just see, as he was describing to me what he was going through, I could just see Father waiting on the other side of an hour. He was waiting just north of an hour. He's like, come on, man. Are you willing to break the barrier? Are you willing? Because you've done it all. You've done all that is required of you. You went all the way up to the hour. But you're going to find me right here at 1:10. He said, I'm going to go. I'm going to go ahead and do this. I want to understand. And he stepped over into a realm, because he said, no, I'm going to stay here till the glory overwhelms me, till the river begins to flow. Hallelujah. And suddenly somebody just found a Holy Ghost meeting outside of the church service. I can tell you, everybody who found the Holy Ghost meeting outside the church service, because they're dancing with me, because they're shouting with me, because there's a Holy Ghost flow in there, because they're not being oppressed by the enemy and held down under a gag order. It's so many people's mouths are stopped up. The wells have been completely plugged up by the Philistines, by demon spirits, by compromised lives. They live under a demonic shroud of depression and oppression. And I pray that every one of you gets so fighting mad. You come and be taught of the Lord how to stand against all the forces of hell, that you no longer can Satan exercise his will to your members. That you find yourself completely and totally liberated as the sons of God. Hallelujah. You walk out, huh? When we go out in joy, and the mountains and the hills break forth into singing. See, look here. Paul said in Romans chapter 8 that all creation groaned in travail, waiting for somebody to show up as a son. Are you listening to me? Woo! Look what happens when the Son comes. Look at what happens when somebody starts moving the authority of the Son. You go out with what? Joy. What happens? The mountain hills break forth into the hallelujah chorus, singing and the shouting, and all the trees of the field, they begin to clap their hands. Oh, my era, my Say this to you. Every move of God where people stepped into the miraculous and the supernatural and the outworking of the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, it happened in the radical environments of extreme passion and emotionalism. Did 90 miles up the street, April 9th, 1906. People were all making fun how emotional all those people were over there. Rolling around on the floor, dancing, shaking. Until the miracles started happening, until the signs and wonders started happening, until all of a sudden a fire began to sweep the nations of the earth. And nobody can deny it now. The history records it. Every great revival took place that way. 120 people risked their life to be in the upper room. They risked their life to be there. And the power and the glory of God begin to shake the place. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. People, it is in this realm where we allow the Holy Ghost to come and begin to be expressed through our kolia, through our belly. Most people don't even know what that means, belly. Kolia. And there's only one definition for it, and it's not colon, which would be the medical term. It's the Attic Greek terminology, which is absolutely impeccable. Emotions and passions. You're going to have to learn how to give your emotions and passions over the Holy Ghost. Then you won't be mad, upset, and discouraged, and angry, and so after all the things that belong to the filth of this world. I tell you right now, when you begin to move in holy emotions, that Paul talked about in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 4. Mandesi catul romosi. Mande brinatus. People, it's sacred. It's so sacred. And the more sacred you allow these things of the Spirit to be. Hallelujah. Just sit down for just a second. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm glad. I'm glad you all standing. Because Father's just going to have a people that are just so radically abandoned over to Him.
Yes.
The moves of God never started in, you know, big ivory palaces of religion. I know that there's people that want to believe that they're going to see another Azusa Street revival. They're going to have a big thing go on the anniversary. And that's good. I mean, everybody ought to be reaching in. But the Lord doesn't come like that. He doesn't come where you got all the great bands on the platform and all the great famous keynote speakers. He don't come there. Never has. I'm not saying He can't. I'm not saying He can't. I'm not going to limit God. He just never has. He comes right down into the crucible of you laying out your life, risking everything with total abandonment. Nothing else satisfies. You've got to have the move of God. So that's the only way it's ever happened. Hallelujah. Every great revival, you name them. You can start with the Wesleyan revival, the Moravian revival, just to name the most recent ones. You can start. You talk about the Great Awakening of the mid-1700s, the Second Great Awakening of the mid-1800s. You know, you're looking at a bunch of broken preachers. You're looking, Father Nash was a broken down, rejected preacher. He raised up a church and he turned 47 years old and they said, you know, we want a younger man. Now the church is finally underway. Now there's enough people in it for it to be something. They go, no, you're too old now. We're voting you out. He finds his knees. Father Nash found his knees. And God partnered up with a guy named Charles Finney. God began to shake the nation of America through two men, broken. Broken and hungry for heaven. I love to think about Alexander the Great, a young man who inherits a kingdom in a small kingdom of Macedon at the age of 20. By the time he's 22, after sitting at the feet of Aristotle, being taught how to be full of the devil, he says, I'm going to conquer the world. In 3 years, he conquers the great empire of the Persians and the Medes. 3 years, he's conquered the world. What am I going to do now? Just conquered the world. Huh? A demon-possessed 25-year-old has completely conquered the world. He's taken kings by the throat, huh? And made the mighty his footstool. Huh? Listening to me. What happens when somebody is willing to give themselves over fully to the Holy Ghost? What happens when somebody begins to believe what God said in His Word and it's real? It's not religion anymore. And they're willing to stand up against all of the satanic opposition that says you can't be anointed. The satanic opposition says it's not true. The satanic opposition says it won't work. The satanic opposition say he's not listening. Huh? You won't bend. I said the millennials are coming.
Yeah.
Huh?
Amen.
Huh? Amen. They'd rather throw up on the platform and turn into one fountain or another than to bend their back. Come on now. Come on now. Look at me. I said, it stops right now. Your body stops. Whatever it's doing right now, it's a spirit of it. This nauseousness stops right now. Right now, you get big and bold and brave and swallow it down. Because that's what it takes, people. It takes whatever measure is necessary. Hey. People are telling us you can't. People are telling us you can't go to the Kashmir Valley. Your problem is that you live under the fear and the intimidation of the God of this world. The reality that I live in is I'm seated with the one who is head over all principalities and power and might, and He's placed me in charge, and I've been willing to take up the mantle. Hello. But they said the same thing to us about the other places we go. They say, you're definitely going to get killed in Nepal. You can't hold a meeting across from the great goddess Shiva and Kali. They've ruled for 3,000 years. Well, I didn't even feel them. I didn't even notice. For 3,000 years, they've offered human sacrifice all day long to her. Every person that's dead or dies, they come and they offer their body and burn and turn it into ashes. That's where cremation got started. You listening to me?
Yes.
And an offering to a violent demon spirit. And it just got transferred over here to America, and people say it's okay, it's cheaper. You listen to me, it's cursed in the Bible. But I didn't even feel it. It had no power over us. We live in another realm. We live in a heavenly realm. I'm being taught just how, you know how I'm being taught? I hysterically lose myself in laughter. I lose the English language. Over. Hallelujah. Where's where I learn to prophesy? Where's where I learn to interpret tongues, which is where I learn to speak by the word of knowledge and by the word of wisdom. It's where I learn discerning of spirits. It's where I learn the working of miracles. It's where I learn the gifts of healing. It's where I learn functioning in a gift of faith. I build up myself in my most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And there is no two ways to pray in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. There's omoneritai. There's one Pentecostal way of praying in the Holy Ghost. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, clothed in tongues of fire, came and rested upon each one of them. And they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Changes everything. Changes your passions, your thinking, your attitudes, your appetites. Huh? Hallelujah. 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 Having begun in the Holy Ghost through this wonderful new birth, are you now made perfect by your own human ability and reasoning and discipline? No, we're made perfect by our suzerain. He's our suzerain. He's your suzerain. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to do anything or make anything happen for me. All I just do is follow him, just love him, say, Lord, I say with total abandonment. I say with total abandonment, Lord, I don't want anything but you. I don't care. I don't need any clothes. I don't need any shoes. I don't need any food. I need you. I need you. And now I'm not just doing what Jesus said. Listen to me. I'm not just, come on, girls. I'm not just doing what Jesus said out of some kind of discipline in Matthew chapter 6, to take no thought or don't be concerned for or take no thought for what you see or what you should wear. A love relationship has captivated my heart. I'm in awe of God. I'm in awe of him. The Lord wants to captivate you tonight. Just that much more. Hallelujah. He's got big plans for you. Veronica's got big plans for you. Hallelujah. And every one of you, I'll name every one of you. I don't leave everybody out. I'm just going to pick on Veronica right now. Her name comes to mind. He's got big plans for you.
Amen.
It's going to cost you something. Your plans.
Amen.
He's created you in him to do his will. It's going to cost you something. Your will. Your will is going to come to bear right, left, and center all over the place tomorrow. All over you, huh? And so many people, you know, I'm one day I'm going to write a book, and it's going to be entitled, You Do Not Recognize Yourself. Something like that. How are you ever going to be able to deny yourself till you recognize self? Jesus, this is the entrance into his ministry. You must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. You must be willing to come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. You must understand what the foot washing service is all about. You must learn how to lay down your life for those who hate you and persecute you and love them. And everybody who's ever done stepped into the glory realm. What do you want? Self-defense, somebody to give you some respect. So what are you going to do with that? What is respect worth on the stock exchange today? Zero. Nothing. You can't trade it for anything. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on, people. Come on. I'm looking for a great moving of the Spirit to take place in your life. I'm looking for you to find yourself in the, as it were, the crucible of faith, the fire furnace of faith, and emerge with the bright glory of the person, Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Huh? Because you're not fazed by it, huh? You're not fazed by the things that you're going through, the challenge that you're dealing with. And you know, I recently suffered a loss because a friend of mine that I had since 14 years old suddenly went home to be with the Lord. And why it was a great loss is because he was so valiant. He was valiant for God. He just finished a 3-day meeting, and there had been great signs and wonders and miracles in the meeting down in Mexico. And it's time to go home. The meeting's over. You're tired. You're worn out. The whole team says, okay, we're going home. And on the way out the door, they set 3 deaf mutes in front of him. All the cameras came out. He's walking towards them. He sees it. He's like, I'm so tired. And the Lord says, whatever you do, don't stop praying. He goes over there and he begins to pray for him. And the oldest deaf mute was around 13 years of age, and she was just rebellious and defiant. She neither could hear nor speak. And as the sign language person was there talking to her, she was just doing every obnoxious gesture you could think of. But my friend did not let up. 45 minutes goes by. That's valiant. That's valiant. We want to do a little prayer, and in the name of Jesus, you just leave it there. No, man, sometimes you got to contend for the faith. You got to fight against a rebellious demon spirit who doesn't want to obey nothing, doesn't believe you believe anything about God. Satan believes he can take you out whenever he wants. And many times he proves it over and over and over again in people's lives. They've never come into a place of understanding how they can walk in a sanctified realm, in a consecrated place, untouched by the powers of darkness. Listen, Job had a little hedge and Satan couldn't touch him. You and I have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. The enemy shouldn't be able to get anywhere near us. Listen to me. All about a little over 45 minutes, and this rebellious girl begins to sob because she can hear. And she begins to speak Jesus. And immediately, the other two that were there broke open. He stood there and broke open a realm. I believe that the woman with the issue of blood broke open a realm of access. To where it was almost like you don't even have to ask. She didn't even ask. She didn't ask. She said within herself, I know who he is. See, Jesus said, if you just recognize who I am, and then what he said to the woman at the well, John chapter 4, if you just recognize who I am and the gift that I have, you'll ask of me. Who's he talking to? Is he talking to another Mary? Is he talking to another virtuous, innocent, pure, holy woman? No, he's talking to a woman who's been married 5 times and is living in adultery. Been married 5 times and living in it 5 times and now is living in adultery. He's saying nothing about the problem. He's telling everything about the answer.
Right.
Just recognize who I am and recognize the gift and I'll give you the drink and the life of God will begin to spring up on the inside of you. That's how easy it is. He's easy. We put him over in the context of religion and we mix him with tradition and philosophy and we end up with nothing but a package that is powerless and leaves people sick and diseased and cantankerous and upset and arguing and fussing and fighting between husband and wife and children and parents and the love of the brethren very, very, very rarely even exists where we lay down our life for the brethren as he showed us. The love of God, which is the access into all the fullness of God, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, and thereby be filled with all the fullness of God, now into him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you think or ask, according to the power that resides in you. Not to the power of heaven that you've got to, you know, rend the heavens and pray down, as I said, begin with.
Gonged.
Amen. Hallelujah. Right here. He's put the gift in me. It's like when the disciples, you know, in the same, pretty much in this whole same, what we would refer to as a pericope. And they come to Jesus and he said, it's getting to be a late hour. The people are hungry. Send them into the nearby villages so that they might buy food and eat. He looks at them and he says, you give them to eat. Think about it. He's looking at you and me and he's saying, you give them to eat. You do it. You work the miracle now. You go set the captives free. You go into all the world and preach the gospel. You go everywhere casting out devils, laying hands on the sick. You go be the witness of who I am because I'm entrusting you. I've empowered you. This is the way Father has set up the program. This is all about the restoration. This is all about the renewal. This is all about bringing men back. And somebody said, oh, we've been restored back to Adam. This is nonsense. We've been brought far beyond. We've been restored beyond all of that. We've been made new in Christ Jesus and seated together with him in the heavenly realm. We've been made higher than all those things that existed in Adam. And yet we still sit as though we have nothing. Consumed with materialism. Consumed with our bank accounts. Consumed with our stuff. Fat on disobedience. Come, people. Soon you're going to break the barrier. My dear friend, such a valiant man, I said, Lord, there's so few laborers as it is. There's so few valiant men as it is. How can you call him home at 59? And so I said, this is just nothing more than demonic then. So I went to raise him from the dead. You should have seen the people at the funeral home. That's when I came in, I said, where's the body? They said, what do you mean? Who are you? I said, I'm the person who's going to come spend the day with the body. We heard about a pastor friend that was coming at 1 o'clock for an hour. I said, no, somebody told you wrong. I'm coming for the day. And they're just looking at me like. I said, I know what you're thinking. I said, you just have to understand. The Lord has commissioned us to raise the dead. And I've come here to raise them from the dead. I said, sir, I'll get the body ready for you right now. Give me just a minute. It's early in the morning. I went in there and went after because it says it's nothing but demonic. I did out, get out, got after him. Get out of this bed. You didn't tell me you were going anywhere in the first place. You didn't even tell me you were feeling bad. So I just said, Papa, I'll do whatever thing he was going to do. And because he didn't raise up from the dead. I mean, I didn't stop because I preached his funeral the next day. Did an open casket. Just told everybody, you know, get ready. Brace yourselves. If you got heart, you know, pacemakers, heart trouble, brace yourself. Hallelujah. It wasn't until I was putting him in the ground that I finally said, okay, man, you know. And released it, and then we got after the thing in another dimension. But I said, Lord, I'll just do what he's going to do and what you want me to do. Unless we can find some people somewhere that will totally abandon and step up, huh? And begin to live their life in the kingdom. Hase dekuna. You're not going to Cuba like that. Did you guys know that it's on? I'm so excited. I was telling people, I was blowing some people away the other day. I just thank God for President Obama. They're like, look at me. I said, what are you talking about? I said, well, I have a different worldview than you do. The crying, praying church of Cuba was believing God that there could be a mass evangelist and crusade in Cuba. President Obama removed the embargo, which then said, okay, we can go in and do a mass evangelism crusade in Havana, Cuba. Hallelujah. And the glory and the power of God is going to be revealed. I've invited Carlos and Acondia to go with me. Elias, his son, is going to go we're going to do a pastor's breakfast. I sent word to Carlos. I said, would you do this crusade with me, you know? Of course, everybody under the sun wants to go because I'm telling you right now, I'm going to invite Castro. Come sit on the platform. Watch it. I feel it. No. You listen to me. I believe that Saddam Hussein died born again. Let me tell you why. First and foremost, he had already given us permission to do a crusade in Baghdad, Iraq. It was going to happen 3 months after the United States of America went and started bombing the place. At the time, I said, you've set. And of course, you talk about getting persecution, man. People just filed out the door. I said, you set missions back 100 years. No, they set missions back 1,000 years. I'll tell you, right now, we're going to redeem the time. Amen. I'm going to tell you what. I'm going to be setting back 1,000 years. This thing is going to be turned back around. We're going to do mass evangelism crusades in Benghazi, Libya, in Damascus, Syria, in Mecca, Saudi Arabia, in Baghdad, Iraq, in Tehran, Iran. I mean, this is going to happen. It's going to happen because we're not going to have it any other way. Yes. We're not going to have it any other way. Come on, send it by you. Harabasar. Hambrebekeshe shipatara. The Father's going to turn this thing around. Huh? He might have to use a Hillary Clinton to turn it around. Somebody said, why? We said, the church is in the leadership. And we've already chosen a progressive agenda. We already allowed the compromise and the demon spirits and the world and the alcohol and the immorality and the carousing. We already chose the liberal agenda. You hear me? We already allowed the homosexual preacher. We already confirmed all the immorality, right, left, and center. So that's what is going to be in the government. So it's going to be in the government. It's just the way it is. But I believe with all my heart the Father is going to, in his mercy,
to turn things in such a way that people can begin to cry out for him. Amen. The church is going to turn back. Yes. And once again, a glorious revival will be seen in the West. But you know what? It's not going to slow down the revival in China. Right now, there's more than 1 million people coming into the kingdom, being baptized in the Holy Ghost every month in China. There's over 200 million. There's a great Holy Ghost revival going on in North Korea. Forget about what they're saying on the news. There is a Holy Ghost revival been going on since 2006. It is unprecedented. North Korea, it used to be Korea, and they were called in that region the people of the Holy Ghost. It's happening all over again. Huh? Hallelujah. The church is on the rise. The church has set the pace of the government. The church, God has given the church the power to make disciples out of nations when the church is functioning in his authority as the sons of God, as the body of Jesus Christ, as the living personal manifestation of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm talking to you. Talking to you. God wants to do a great thing through your life. And you know what we're doing right now is Father is... Every week goes by and the calendar's filling up. I mean, I'm starting to broadcast Geneva now. And I say, well, you know what? My calendar's filling up. We got Geneva. Because the Lord is sending us to the churches of America. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God's put a word in our mouth. Receive the life of God. Receive the life of Christ. It's time for the church to receive the life of Jesus Christ. The very life of God. His very life. Instead of saying that you've received his life, let's see the fruit of the life. Let's see the fruit brought forth unto perfection. Let's see the reality, the demonstration of the person Jesus Christ that shows forth the character and the nature of Almighty God with a total abandonment to do Father's will instead of caring about our own things all day long. Come on now. The millennials are coming. I see it. I see it on you. Hallelujah. I was so blessed looking at Clara. Debbie, just looking at all of you. Zoe, just looking at all of you. When was I here last? Sunday night. Just seeing the anointings, the giftings. Don't stop. You follow me. You follow Ruth. Don't follow anybody else who's not passionately pursuing the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Forget about, block them all out. They're irrelevant. They don't count. You follow people who's in hot pursuit for the outpouring of God in their life. And imitate what's going to happen. You're going to inherit all that Father has supplied. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. I pray that parents will begin to become like Hannah. Give their children over to God. Instead of, religious, selfish, fearful, possessive. Controlling parents, holding on to kids, teaching them how to be like them. Are you listening to me? You need to give them over to the Holy Ghost Church. Yes, sir. You need to. Russia carried the mantle of revival, carried the torch of revival for more than 100 years, almost 150 years, right? And then all of a sudden the church became... They have become all conceited. Then start talking about what kind of robes they should wear, how long they should be. They'll start getting themselves all prettied up, huh? And getting themselves bigger rings, huh? Getting themselves more kisses on the hand, more control over the people. Such iniquity, such greed stepped into the Russian church. That the Bolshevik Revolution took place. It's true. And now it emerges as it is right now. And I don't want to talk about that. I don't want to depress us with comparisons. But I see there's America in the Western world isn't going to stop what God's doing in Asia. It's powerful. It's a powerful move of God. Supernatural signs and wonders. They're living the New Testament dream right now in Asia. And it's time for Kashmir.
Amen.
So we're just gonna go write history, amen, God. We're just gonna do Hebrews chapter 11 and subdued nations.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
40 million Pashtuns, they believed themselves to be the descendants of Ephraim. See, Ephraim was the mighty tribe of the northern kingdom of Israel that was exiled in 760 B.C. because of their sin and iniquity. And Ephraim, by and large, was exiled over into the kingdom of the Medes in the Sacrus Mountains. But then ultimately they migrated and ended up the majority of all the Pashtuns, which they call themselves the Ephraimites, are now in the mountains of Afghanistan and Pakistan, and mostly on the eastern side down into the valley of Kashmir. Praise God. I just see it. I see great revivals. I see great Holy Ghost revivals sweeping India. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I'm going to see the stronghold of religion, Christian religion broken in Kerala. Amen. So from the south all the way to the extreme north. Amen. Come on, man. Come on, man. You listen to me. I'm talking to you, Daniel. You need to break that stronghold of religious stuff to keep you from flowing in the Holy Ghost. And do it for Kerala. Do it for Kerala. I guarantee you. God, you know, Father is hastening. He's watching over his word to hasten it. He's looking for some people who will lay hold on him. He's looking at you and me, and he's saying to us, you give them to eat. You multiply the bread. You multiply the fishes. You do the miracle. Amen. They didn't know how to get started, so you know what he did? He took a few loaves, and he broke them off each a piece. And they're standing there with this piece. He said, you do it now. Do what? Feed the 5,000. To each thing he gave a portion of fish. Few loaves, few fish, among 12 big guys. One hand, little piece of bread. Other hand, little portion of fish. They did it. By the master's command, you do it. He's saying to you and me, you do it. He's saying to you and me, are you willing to break open a realm of access into divine, a realm of access into the miraculous? I'm just simply not going to be willing to let up on the possibility that the woman with the issue of blood, who didn't even ask God permission, but snuck up behind him, touched him, and by sneaking up behind him and touching him, drew out of him the very power, the very dunamis to immediately cure her. So that Jesus stopped and said, wait a minute, what's just happened here? I felt the anointing go out of me. And the woman, realizing that she could not be hid, revealed everything to him. He says, woman, be good cheer, your faith has made you whole. It spreads throughout all, everywhere. Gennesaret, they're begging him, let me touch your garment too. Let me touch your garment too. Pleading with him. Thank you, Jesus. What are you going to do with your life here tonight? I pray in the name of Jesus. From this day forward, you'll recognize that Christ is in you. That God has given you the gift of the Holy Ghost. There's no limitations upon you. Don't let men put limitations on you. Don't let demon spirits put limitations on you. Don't live to make $1 trillion. Live to show forth the power and the glory of Almighty God. Amen. Father doesn't need another person making money for the kingdom and dying in the process. Amen. Without a will. Amen. He needs people to learn how to begin to move in the gift of faith and cause those things which are not as though they were. Amen. Who speak by spirit knowledge and say to the moon and to the sun, don't move. Who speak by spirit knowledge and say to the axe, said float. Who speak by the spirit knowledge and say to the rock, give us some water now. Amen. Who speak by spirit knowledge and say to the oil and to the flower, do not diminish and it obeys. Amen.